This is The Sit Down, and I'm here with Soledad O'Brien, host of Matter of Fact.
Hey.
Hi. How are you this morning?
I'm really well, actually. Really good. How about you? You're so funny. I was sitting in the green room laughing my butt off.
Thank you. You cracked me up.
I'm caught up on the Kardashians.
So now, listen.
Win-win-win.
I'm trying to keep it well-rounded
Thank you.
Here.
I appreciate that. And I don't actually have to watch.
Yes.
Win-win-win-win-win.
No, so I want to start by, obviously, sending you my condolences about your mother.
Oh, thank you, yeah.
Passing. Can you tell us about her and what she meant to you?
Sure. Oh, my gosh. My mom was the classic immigrant mom. She grew up in Cuba in the 1930s. And, you know, immigrant moms are very loving and they will tell you off. And
yes.
They are pushing for you and praying for you.
Yes.
She had a lot of great advice. One of the things that I really miss about my mom is that she had great advice for women. Like, she'd love you because you have a lot of energy and attitude and you are striving for it. And she loved a woman who was, like, going for it. And then she'd give you some advice and she'd be like, but really, find Jesus. If you could find Jesus.
Her and my immigrant mother would
Well, you know, right? So she was like, and like the world can be, if you would just make your bed, you'd see how the world would come together. She was just great in a lot of ways. My dad died 40 days earlier.
Yes.
So I lost both my parents. But they were great. Listen, I could not have asked for better parents. They were actually the couple, the ACLU asked them to be the couple that would test the ban on interracial marriages.
Wow.
Because my mom's black and Cuban. Yes. My dad is white. He was from Australia. And their marriage was illegal in 1959. They said, no. Any chance of history.
They were like, no.
They're like, no, do the loving family because why not?
Yeah. There's so much rich history there with your family and your upbringing. How did your parents' life together inspire the way you're raising your own family?
You know what? So my mom, again, immigrant mom, used to always say, oh, so you have a nanny with four kids. You know, I raised six kids and I didn't need any help. But, I mean, you know, do what you need to do. So I guess it's a combination of Catholic guilt.
Yes.
And bribery and blackmail. I think what my parents did really well was they just wanted us to be happy and good people. And I think that when I hear about this, you know, obviously this cheating scandal that you guys have been talking about, they just were never into any idea that their children weren't good as they were,
right,
wherever they went to school, whatever they decided to do, and that sort of moral values were the most important thing.
For sure.
So it's really, I mean, you know, I think it was that they valued education. They were both educators. I think that they also were very much about pushing for racial justice. I grew up in an all-white town in Long Island, so like alone in the desert.
Oh God! Yeah, I can imagine. But what and another thing I really loved about the thread itself, you know, as a first gen myself, was how you spoke
about. Where's your family
about
from?
Kenya.
Oh.
So they're from Kenya, which is on the east side of Africa.
She's like, let me tell you about
it. In case you were wondering,
is not a country.
It's a continent. But yes, I loved how you were talking about her journey, and it made me wonder also, like, how does it impact your take on the immigration laws now and that whole debate?
Well, you know, there was a time not so long ago where we looked at immigrants as a value to America, and I actually think we'll get back to that time. I mean, I think the issue of immigration is actually just used as a wedge issue for people who are just racist and bigots. I mean, we've just seen that leverage, and it's actually been disappointing to see reporters not call that bullshit out. Am I allowed to curse?
Yes, you are. Oh, you are very allowed to curse.
Yes. Now that it's done. You know, it's been disappointing not to hear reporters who have opportunities to interview the First Lady, for example, not to talk to her about being a birther. She's a birther. I mean, I'm not making this up. And so it's been very disappointing to see reporters sort of massaging or open asking, you know, yes, no questions to people when actually, if I think they were better prepared, they'd do a better job in doing aggressive, strong interviews, which is what they should be doing. So, listen, I think the nation's value is in diversity and immigration. And I think we as a country believe this. I travel the country often a lot. Mm-hmm. I have the honor of having a gajillion miles on Delta and American Airlines.
I'm talking Moscow miles every day.
Right, right. The only time I love it is when they're like, super duper platinum plus, get in line. Like me, that's me, everybody.
Excuse me, get out of my way.
I believe I have 78 million miles. You and your kid can move. You know, but so when you travel around the country, you really see that actually people we all have relatives who come from somewhere else. And right. I do think we do love a story about immigration. So I think we'll come back to that. Right now it's just a wedge issue for people who are racist and bigots.
Yeah. And, you know, I think this is also a great example. You talked about how the media, like, has been massaging things, sort of. And, like, you've always been super direct and critical of the president and his policies. Are you?
Not everybody loves that. Just saying.
I know, but are you surprised that he hasn't called you out specifically yet? Because he seems like that's a thing he likes to do.
No, I think he looks for the, first of all, I'm pretty sure he doesn't watch my show. I do a political show called Matter of Fact, and I'm pretty sure that he doesn't watch it. He really watches Fox News. And
right.
I also think our show does not do round-the-clock Trump TV, which is really both depressing and also sad, because I think television news could do better. We report on news, things that are happening to people around the country, and we've actually seen a big impact on our ratings. We were just in Puerto Rico doing a show in Puerto Rico. We look at students who are homeless and hungry. We take a look at the housing issues in the United States, and we really look at real diversity around the country, meaning diversity everywhere. So I think because we do that, we're not really a political show that deals with politicians. I don't even have that many politicians on the show. We do people, right? What are the policies that affect human beings? Why are there a bunch of people in San Diego who've moved to Mexico because they cannot afford to live in the United States? And they reverse commute into the United States for work and then go home. These are American citizens. Go home to Mexico because they can't afford the cost of living.
Yeah.
Those are the kinds of stories that we do and analyze versus Congressman A is now going to scream at Congressman B. And by the way, as the moderator, I'll just stir the pot.
Do you feel like that's why, you know, I love that you own your own media or the company. And do you feel like that's why it's important to, like, for a woman, especially a woman of color, to have a stake in this game, to be able to bring these other sides of the story in a world where it seems to be the cable commentary has gotten very...
It's just low. I mean, it doesn't add value, which is what I think is the saddest thing, is that it actually doesn't add a lot of value. Yeah, you know, I think, listen, I know Kenyans, Nigerians, and Cubans are like, own your stuff, right? Anybody who's had to potentially lose everything is like, own everything, everything you can.
Take equity.
Yeah, so I think that there is a value in not just owning your own company, but having a platform and an authentic voice to talk about issues. That's probably my biggest issue, is that I think if you were to ask a lot of these journalists, they would say, some of the stuff I'm doing is shit, and I know it's shit, but this is where I get my salary from, and I have to do it. I have to stand up here and talk about stuff and stir the pot and have 75 people on this panel who will all weigh in for 8 seconds, not because I'm adding value in a difficult discussion for the American people, but because this is cheap. It's cost efficient, it's cost effective, and it gets ratings, or good enough ratings. I mean, we found our little show, which is, we're in our third season. I mean, we just beat everything on cable. And I think it's just because we have stories about interesting topics, and they're very diverse, and a lot of millennials. Who would have thought millennials would watch?
We love you.
I appreciate that. Thank you, millennials. I know. When people start calling me auntie on Twitter, I'm like, auntie.
You were like, no.
No, sister. I'm your big sister.
I love that.
Auntie.
But you know, you were talking about cable news, and you were formerly on CNN.
Yeah, I worked for CNN for 10 years.
Do you feel like that's why you've been extra critical of them? Because you kind of know what those people are going through?
I know the pay structure. I know how you book a story. I know exactly what goes into all those meetings. I have a number of friends, obviously, who still work there. And I love CNN. I mean, when we covered Hurricane Katrina, I remember walking through the airport in Baton Rouge after being camped out there for about 3 weeks. Mm. None of us could take showers. I was smart enough to bring a bag of baby wipes because I had just had my kids. Mm. And I remember, and people gave us a standing ovation. Right. So this idea that everybody hates the media is a relatively recent phenomenon. And some of that is because people understand the media is not serving them. But this is just bull. This is a ratings grab, and it's cheap. All those people are on the payroll. They make something like $100,000 to $150,000 as a contributor for a year.
Right.
So as you circle them through, it's inexpensive. And to have people yelling at each other as opposed to sending a crew into the field to tell a complex story, obviously one is much cheaper. One serves the public better, but one's cheap. And so you know, that's why they do it. And I know the system well. So yeah, I'm very critical of an organization that I think could do much better.
Yeah.
Could serve people better. There are a lot of great journalists working there. They could do, you know, more thoughtful. There's so many issues we could be covering right now that are not just screaming about President Trump between elected officials who often just don't even know what the hell they're talking about.
Right. So like more journalism.
Yeah, report. I don't know. I was thinking reporting on this
reporting,
in this news channel.
It might be a good idea. No, but this is a Twitter show, morning show.
I love Twitter, and I hate Twitter.
To
and
not
I love
talk
Twitter.
About how great you are at Twitter.
I am really good at it. Too bad it doesn't pay any money. I feel like Jack maybe doesn't pay money because I send him hate notes all the time because he's, you know. But
Do you have like a strategy to leveraging on
yes,
Twitter?
Yes. I really think Twitter, don't bother if you can't be straightforward and honest. Just don't bother, really. Yep. I mean, anybody who does like ads and stuff, I don't think it really works. I think you have to be very, for me, just very blunt and straightforward. I love engaging with people on Twitter,
yeah.
but I've gotten better about just, you know, muting or deleting people.
Thank God
altogether.
For that meat, right?
Oh my God,
and
it really was good. But you know, I really wish, sometimes you're like, Jack, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
I just spent a week meditating. And you're like, yeah, so you know such and such just happened in the news. Are you not on Twitter that you don't know what's going on? It's a really frustrating platform, but I also feel like it's so far the best thing.
Yeah, true. Well, thank you for joining us, Soledad.
My pleasure.
You can watch Soledad every weekend on Matter of Fact.